Hello again. In New Zealand, to be involved in a series of workshops and to talk to scientists here is internationally renowned soils ecologist Dr. Christine Jones, and she joins us now. Christine, welcome.
Thank you, Roger.
Now, Christine, back home they call you the carbon goddess. How did that come about?
Oh, well, obviously because of my good looks, but may have also been because I was the first person to put soil carbon on the national agenda in Australia. I ran a series of managing the carbon cycle forums around the country, and also established Amazing Carbon and the Australian Soil Carbon Accreditation Scheme.
And your broader message is that we need a fundamental redesign of agriculture and our whole approach to food and food production.
That's right, yeah. We do, because we have now have the lowest nutrient density in our food than we've ever had at any time in history, and we can relate that to what's happening health-wise. I can't give you figures for New Zealand, but in Australia our health bill is now running at $100 billion and it's 8% of our GDP, which is far higher than it's ever been. I suppose in practical terms I could say our hospitals are overfilled, basically the health system is crashing.
What's that got to do with carbon?
It's got absolutely everything to do with carbon, because most of the diseases are nutritionally related, so that things like cancer and cardiovascular disease, diabetes, all of these things are related to the fact that we don't have the trace elements in our bodies that we need for our immune systems to work. And the reasons we don't have the trace elements is because our soils are not functioning anymore. So carbon is all about the function of the soil. So when I'm talking to farmers and in the workshops that I run, we talk about how do we get this gas, carbon dioxide, to become a liquid in a plant, so it becomes glucose dissolved in the sap of the plant. How do we get that from the plant out into the soil through the roots and out to feed the microbes in the soil? Because it is the microbial activity in the soil that brings trace elements to plants. They bring lots of trace elements, including things like zinc, to plants in exchange for the sugar, and the sugar is carbon. So basically when CO2 gas is fixed in photosynthesis in the leaves of the plant, it forms the sugar that the plant then exchanges for minerals. Now, if that process is disrupted, and it is disrupted if we add high analysis nitrogen like urea or anhydrous ammonia, or high analysis P like superphosphate or MAP, DAP, I'm not sure which forms are the most commonly used in this country, but I'm sure it's fairly similar to Australia. We find that we're pretty much on the same page with most things agricultural. They just completely inhibit that process so that the plant will still grow, and above ground everything looks the same, but below ground everything's completely different. And that plant may look the same, but it's not the same, because it doesn't have the trace elements in it.
So your message really is that there's a couple of free things out there we can use to farm with, as opposed to things we have to pay for.
Exactly. So if we get the biology working and we get microbial diversity again in soils, we can use the free CO2, free sunlight energy. We can stimulate that whole biological process, manage the carbon cycle, which is really what we are talking about, managing that cycle for the benefit of farmers to get soils to function the way they have for millennia. And the other thing about managing the carbon cycle, of course, the other topical thing is climate change, and the fact that some people say there's excess CO2 in the atmosphere. So if that CO2 can be fixed as glucose and used to feed microbes in the soil, that then means that our plants, our animals and people have more trace elements in their systems. You know, every year, if we look at the planet, there's millions and millions of tons of excess nitrogen and excess phosphorus going into aquatic systems and into aquifers, into rivers, into the oceans. And those chemicals are not meant to be there. I mean, that's aside from all the, you know, what we consider to be toxic chemicals like our herbicides and pesticides and those sorts of things. But there's a huge amount of fertilizer. That's completely unnecessary. It's damaging the ecosystem.
Yeah, and it's wasted money. It's washed out into the sea.
Exactly. So we're wasting money, but we can also use all the free resources that the planet has coming to it every day.
Just finally, ETS is a big issue here in New Zealand. Now, you've said that you don't see them as being really any kind of the long-term answer to managing carbon emissions. So why is that?
I don't really believe that a trading scheme would make any difference, because what happens with any kind of trading is that carbon then becomes a commodity, And the true value of carbon is not recognised. It's the people that are doing the trading that would be making the money rather than the farmers. If we had an incentive scheme where farmers were paid to build carbon in their soil, then all of the benefits that I've talked about in terms of the improved water holding capacity and nutrient availability in soils and the health of the plants, the animals and the people would come through. There would be a very good reason for government to incentivise that.
Well, I think that view will have won you a few allies in farming circles here. Christine, thanks very much for coming in.
Thank you, Roger.